Hello, welcome to another episode of the Waffle Press Movie Podcast. I am your host, Diego Crespo. With me today, I have one of my co-hosts, Gene Versa. Gene, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good. Pretty good. A little tired.
How's life?
It's going good. I'm finishing up my second movie with the Asylum.
Yay!
Woo!
Yeah, I can't say what it is, but yeah, it's wrapping up today. Today's the I go in tonight, and then I'll be finished. The last movie I did is actually coming out. It came out on Void yesterday. It's called Alien Convergence, and it's coming out on DVD June 27th. So if anyone feels like watching it, please do. You know, it'd be cool. You could see something that I worked on.
All right, for sure, for sure. And we have another guest here today, a returning guest to the show, Brandon Swofford. How are you doing?
Woo! I'm doing good, guys. I'm excited to be here. It's a lot of fun. I popped my waffle cherry last year, and now I am back, and it feels good to be back with you guys.
Awesome. It feels good to have you back, man. What have you been up to?
Just working on the YouTube. That's going well. For those of you who have not subscribed to Bmoneyrulz, please do. I do mashup trailers for those who know, and they're pretty okay. Working on a couple of short films right now, and just keeping busy, staying busy.
That's good.
Yeah, no, definitely check out Bmoneyrulz on YouTube. Your trailer mashups are awesome. I always take time out of my day to watch them because they're always funny and exciting, and they play out like the legitimate trailers just with a bunch of Disney stuff, wow. Usually. Well, and it's great.
Bless you. Bless you. Thank you.
Is there any trailer that we could check out for listeners?
There's always one that you can check out.
That came out recently?
Right now. Yeah. The newest one was the... the Spider-Man Homecoming one with Big Hero 6. And you also have a guest star of Buzz Lightyear as Tony Stark. It may sound silly. It may sound silly, but just check it out. Just type in Disney Pixar Spider-Man Homecoming mashup trailer, and I think you'll enjoy it.
Awesome.
I actually did catch that one. That one's awesome.
Oh, thanks, man. Appreciate that.
Of course. And then in other news, it's sadder news. Since our last recording of the show, Sir Roger Moore, has since passed away. Yeah. Talent, a gentleman, a scholar, and the first Bond that we're losing in cinematic history. It is a sad day indeed. Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
I think it was last week. It just, I think I woke up to the news and it was just, I know he was pretty up there in the years, but, just very, really took me off guard that he passed away. I think he had cancer, but, it's really sad to see, one of the first Bonds go. But I think technically, no, it's not really canon, but, I think Peter Sellers would have been someone that played a Bond. He's not an official Bond, but...
Pink Panther? Jacques Clouseau?
Oh, no, he did a Casino Royale parody.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, so... But, yeah, Roger Moore is the first official Bond. So, yeah, it's just, a sad thing. His movies were campy, but, they were fun. They were fun, spy movies.
Mm-hmm. And what I loved about him the most was he was always in on the joke. He was always having fun, and he always sold it. And have you guys ever, not only like For Your Eyes Only and Man with the Golden Gun, all those great Bond movies, and he did the most, which was so cool. But he had such a great sense of humor. Have you guys ever seen Boat Trip?
Seen Boat Trip.
It's with Cuba Gooding Jr. and a guy from Saturday Night Live, and they go on a boat to meet a woman, but they accidentally go on a gay cruise ship. And Roger Moore is the king of it, and he plays this gay old man, and he sells it, and he's funny as hell. And it's not just a cameo where he goes in and out; he has a major part, and he's awesome in it.
Yeah. No, I've heard good things about that movie.
It's a really fun
neat
one.
To go. Yeah, you know, he was always, you know, his comedic timing was like, you know, the best out of all the Bonds, I want to say. And, you know, seeing his other work too really, you know, really affirms that. Do you have a favorite Bond moment of his?
Oh, that's tough.
Nah, not really.
I will say my favorite is The Spy Who Loved Me.
Okay.
Yeah, I really like that one. That one's grown on me a lot because I used to just not be into the Roger Moore Bond movies.
Right.
But my taste in movies have like changed and evolved, and I really like that one a lot.
Yeah. Oh, well, Moonraker is a classic.
Oh yeah, Moonraker's great.
Moonraker's a fun, dumb, guilty pleasure, right?
It's it's blinking on me. But what's the movie where he's parachuting down the slopes, and then he parachutes with like a Union Jack flag?
That's Spy Who Loved Me.
Oh, okay, that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's probably my favorite Roger Moore moment. You know?
Oh yeah, that's like a defining Bond movie moment.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but you know what a shame to lose him. Did you guys see the note that went viral that he left to like a fan?
No.
There was a, I think it was like a writer, for some film journal. They were talking about they saw him as a kid and they didn't really know who he was. They just knew he was Bond. So I think their like grandfather went up to Roger Moore and he asked for his autograph and stuff and. He signed it Roger Moore, and then like the kid was surprised that he thought it was Bond, and then so he told him like, oh, he told like the grandpa who didn't really know James Bond, like, you know, this is the wrong person. So then the grandfather got pissed off and like told him like, oh, you know, you're lying to my son. And then, you know, he played it off, and then he like whispered to the kid, it's like, oh, you know, I signed it Roger Moore because that's my cover because I'm on duty right now. Keep it between us that I'm actually James Bond, so you know.
Oh, that's great.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Wow.
What a great
actor. And
rest in peace.
And he lived a long life. He died 88, 89.
Oh, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. In my eyes, when you go past 80, you've made it. You're good.
Yeah.
So, and I'm glad for everything he's done. So. Yeah, mm-hmm. But he will be missed, and it's a shame that he's the first Bond to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, rest in peace. You leave behind quite the cinematic legacy.
Mm-hmm.
But we're moving on now, and there's a couple little tidbits of movie news we got to go into before we get into the meat and potatoes of the show.
Oh, yeah.
What do you guys feel about director Bong Joon-ho?
I really like him. I've, you know... I think what was the movie he did right before this Netflix movie?
Snowpiercer.
Snowpiercer. Yeah, I love
Snowpiercer.
Yeah, Snowpiercer.
That's a really cool movie.
Snowpiercer is incredible. That's like you don't need a BioShock movie after that. First of all, but yeah, that was great.
That was amazing. Yeah, I saw the trailer. How do you pronounce it?
Okja.
Okja. Okja. Yeah. Oh, it's Okja.
I think it's. Okja.
Okay.
But you guys check out this trailer. What did you think?
I think it looks cool. It's a little Dora the Explorer running around with this big hippo pig, I guess. And I like Steven Yeun from The Walking Dead, and Jake Gyllenhaal's in this. It's got a phenomenal cast, and it's got the great Tilda Swinton, Paul Dano. It looks really, really cool, and. Is this based on anything, like a comic book or
No, I don't think so. I think this is just a script just an original script.
That's great. And that intrigues me a little more because we need more original stuff. And
of course.
And Netflix is coming out with good material lately. Oh. So
yeah, you know, I'm
in.
Yeah, I was really impressed by the last movie they did, War Machine, that came out.
Yeah. I heard it was really good. Yet. I haven't got a chance to watch it, but Brad Pitt doing a Netflix show, okay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Definitely. Yeah, you know, I think Netflix movies are finally catching up to its TV shows, or maybe its TV shows have gone down after seeing Iron Fist, you know.
Yeah.
But,
Well, it'll pick up at the Defenders.
Yeah. I think Okja will probably be like the first. Probably the most standout of all the Netflix films that have been released. Yeah. You know? And I think this
Will be released in theaters at all or just on Netflix?
I don't know.
It will get a limited release for like a day. I think that's how the Netflix does it. They stream, and then for the really big movies, like Beast of No Nation was in theaters for like a weekend or two, I think, also.
Mm-hmm. And the movie of Will Smith's going to be on theaters for just a little bit, from what I've heard. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm very much looking forward to it as well. Have you guys seen The Host?
Who's that? Who's The Host? Not the
Stephanie Meyer one. It's another Bong Joon-ho movie.
Oh, I did see that. I saw that one like a long time ago. It was on G4.
Yeah, that one, that's a great movie. And this feels kind of like the inverse of that, where that one, a monster kidnaps a little girl, and here the little girl is trying to rescue a creature of sorts, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's just a cool little, like, that might make a cool double feature someday.
All right.
I really like the way Jake Gyllenhaal looks in this movie too. Like, I don't know if it's going to be a good performance, but he looks fucking insane.
I don't think he knows how to give a bad performance. He's always good.
Yeah, that's true.
Even in Prince of Persia, he was good.
Yeah.
Right.
I thought.
Yeah, you know what? Even like, I personally haven't liked a Jake Gyllenhaal movie for a while, but you know what? He's never bad. Yeah.
He's never bad.
Yeah, so props to him. Any other thoughts on this trailer?
It looks cool, and I hope I get to see it in theaters, because that looks like a movie I'd want to see in a theater and not just on my TV screen or laptop.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it looks good. I'm excited.
And we have this tab for later in the news discussion, but let's just talk about it right now. So at Cannes, there was a big discussion, or argument rather, about how Netflix is ruining or saving movies. What do you guys think of this? Yeah, there was booing, there was disruption, there was chaos, and there was, obviously, because criticism is only nuanced and never hyperbolous, it was not level-headed, and there's a big... I mean, it's been happening for a little while, but
yeah.
Is Netflix doing good for movies? I mean, if they're not showing them in theaters, you know, is that still like a movie experience? There's all these interesting discussions happening around it.
I might say something that might be taken offended. I don't think Netflix or Amazon Prime is really ruining people going to the movies. No. I think movie tickets are too expensive.
Yeah,
and that's why people aren't going to the movies as much as they used to. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think it's like tickets, prices, and a lot of other factors, but I don't really see how Netflix and Amazon are destroying like the theaters, because they still release a lot of their movies in the friggin' theaters.
Yeah, but, that's true.
Yeah, you know, Manchester by Sea. What was the other Neon Demon, all in theaters. Netflix makes a point to actually put them in the movie theaters as well for like a weekend or something. So, you know, I don't know. I can't see the effect of how it's directly, you know, destroying the theater. Maybe it's just, you know, if people find it easier, but, you know, at the end of the day, they're still watching like movies, you know?
That's true.
Yeah. I'm on board with you guys. I can understand the uncertainty around it, because like anything that's new and bold, there's going to be imperfections and mistakes along the way, but Netflix is letting people make stories that they want to make. I mean, it doesn't always work. I mean, obviously you brought up Iron Fist earlier, Gene, which is, you know, probably the big like redheaded stepchild of all of Netflix right now. But yeah, like every director or creator that's worked with Netflix says like, this is it. Like this is what we want, because they're getting to do what they want to do with support and big budgets. Like I think Okja was made for like $60 million.
Yeah, that's crazy.
You know, $50 or $60 million. And that's crazy. And they just let him make that.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, as long as Netflix is supporting original ideas and getting more new content out there, I support. And with so many reboots and stuff, I'm all in for that.
They just need less Adam Sandler movies.
I don't have to watch it. It's okay.
Yeah, you know, that's also the beauty of movies too. If you don't see something that looks like it's your cup of tea, like. I just thought Iron Fist looked bad, so I'm not going to watch Iron Fist until The Defenders. I'll catch up, you know?
You don't need to watch it. You don't need to watch it.
I'll catch up on, like, the previously on all these shows. I'll be like, okay.
right.
But, yeah, I mean, I'm not going to watch any of the Adam Sandler movies because I'm probably not going to like them, you know? And if they need to make those deals with Adam Sandler to be able to produce stuff like Okja or the new Brad Pitt war movie, or any of, like, Stranger Things, you know, then, you know what, then cool, you know, then more power to them. They know how to function as a business, so.
Yes, they do.
One last thing on the cons audience, you know, they're always, like, super, like, decisive and, like, super, you know, emotional.
They love to boo. They love to drink, and then they boo, and. They kind of come off as spoiled kids.
Yeah, and you know, just as a movie audience, like, I really don't want to hear critiques on a film based on people who's based on, like, a whole culture that loves the shit out of Jerry Lewis. That's their favorite actor. You know.
Yeah, I see what you mean, and don't you think it's a little immature to? Like, the people who made the movie are there with you, the directors, the actors, the writers, and after the film you yell, boo.
Yeah.
Like, you don't have to say anything. Just walk out if you didn't like it, or move on.
They're not children. I mean, these are professional film critics, and you're booing. I mean, like, okay, like, I went bowling for the first time in, like, a decade the other day, right? Mm-hmm. And I did real bad. So naturally, you know, my friends will be like, boo, you know, like, it's funny because
we're
friends. You don't do that to someone you don't know who's showing you something they're probably really proud of.
I know.
Yeah, you know, and it's, you know, kind of, I don't know, driving away filmmakers as well from that.
Yeah. And I really liked, obviously, I love them just as human beings, Will Smith and Jessica Chastain, but how they brought up systemic issues about race and gender. You know, Will Smith just casually saying, like, you know, you could put some black people in these movies, wouldn't hurt you. And just like how there's not a lot of stories about women in movies. Mm-hmm. They're there, but they're not really there. And hopefully that's something that changes in the near future. You know,
Totally. Yeah, I agree with both of them.
Yeah, so they made some good statements.
Yeah. And on a lighter note, there's an issue with the Universal Monsters universe, which is officially going by the Dark Universe.
Yay! And, they should call it trying to be Marvel Universe.
Yeah, they should just call it the Universal Monsters universe or something, but they're not. They're calling it the Dark Universe.
Right? Like, this isn't DC.
By DC already. So. I don't know. It's weird.
If the Mummy flops, they're going to be really upset. They took that nice picture with Tom Cruise and Johnny Depp and Javier Bardem and Russell Crowe. And
it's like, do you guys remember the Comic-Con? I don't know if it was Comic-Con. There was, like, a photo of the Fox comic universe, and it was like all the Fantastic Four people and like all the X-Men people.
And Channing Tatum was in it saying, "Hi, I'm Gambit." Well, not yet.
Where it's like they're so sure that it's going to do well, and then it just, I don't know. Well, I mean, we don't know if the Mummy will tank, but it reminds me of, like, when the Fantastic Four tank.
I know, but apparently the Mummy's not tracking well, so if it flops, then... Well, are they still going to make these movies, or?
I bet they'll still make them, but they're going to stop making them big action blockbusters.
Mm-hmm.
I bet they're going to make them, like, low-key horror movies. Because, I mean...
Like Blumhouse or something.
Yeah.
That could work.
it's so weird to me that they're like, oh, we don't, like, I'll never forget. It was a couple years ago. The Amazing Spider-Man series was still a thing with Sony. And they had this THR roundtable for all these producer heads talking about their cinematic universes. And the Universal lady was like, I forget who it was. She was saying how they don't have superheroes, but what they do have is Universal monsters. That sounds cool. And she's like, so we're going to make them more action oriented, more, there be our own superheroes. And it's like, whoa, that is not what you should do. You have the iconic movie monsters. Make a horror movie franchise, you know?
Was that before they did Dracula Untold? Or like,
I think that was right after, and that wasn't really part of it. It was either before or after. Oh. It doesn't matter anymore because that was...
Yeah, that's not going to be part of this universe, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Or I, Frankenstein, the Aaron Eckhart, Frankenstein with abs.
Oh, my God. I, Frankenstein is the best because in Spanish, I is yo. So the Spanish language posters all say yo, Frankenstein.
Oh, God.
Yo, Frankenstein!
Yeah. I want that poster so badly. But anyways, what do you guys think of this Dark Universe nonsense?
You know, it just, I don't know, I think they've never had a good grasp on the Universal monsters when they've been trying to reboot them, like, you know, from Van Helsing to, like, you know, Dracula 2000, they just never did it right. And just, like, just everything about, like, all the people they hired, like Johnny Depp as the Invisible Man, it's just nothing excited me, you know?
I know. Same.
Maybe having Johnny Depp invisible, where you don't have to see him, is kind of...
That's nice. I like that.
Yeah, that's nice.
I think more movies should do that. Make them
yeah.
News has got out that they're reaching out to The Rock to be the Wolfman and Angelina Jolie to be the Bride of Frankenstein. So,
yeah, I saw those reports. Didn't those come out like a year ago too?
Really?
Yeah, I don't know why everyone started reporting it again. Like that's like, I don't know. That was weird to me that made headlines again because that made headlines before. But also on that show, Dwayne Johnson as the Wolfman seems weird to me too.
Yeah,
he's too big.
Yeah, there's no arc there. There's nothing exciting about that. A big guy who gets bigger.
How big is he gonna be? He's gonna be King Kong. This is already a big dude when he gets bigger.
Isn't he already playing like a, I don't know, what the fuck, for Rampage? Do you guys remember the video game?
Yeah.
What the fuck are they? They're like werewolves or monsters? He's already playing like
they're kaiju.
It's a kaiju, gorilla, a crocodile, and something else.
You know, he's already playing like a werewolf creature.
Well, no, he's not playing the creatures. He's playing the hero that fights them.
Yeah, he's playing a doctor or professor or something.
Never mind.
But, I don't know.
Yeah, he's just... Yeah, he doesn't...
He loves franchise.
Yeah.
No. Can you... Oh, can you smell the Rock? Is howling.
Right.
You know, if that's in the movie, I'll give it 5 stars.
The more I think about it, the more I'm like, okay. I love The Rock, so, I mean, but after seeing Baywatch, I know he can't save everything.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
No, it's fine. It's all right. It's over. It's over. Ain't it's done. It's done.
Yeah, I don't know. None of the Dark Universe stuff is just interesting.
Well, I've heard the script for The Mummy is really good. Yeah, that's all I've heard. Yeah,
we'll see you next week.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, I kind of wish they brought Brendan Fraser back, but I don't know.
I love Brendan Fraser. I love Brendan. I have a guilty pleasure of Brendan Fraser. Everyone hates him, and I don't know why. I think he's so likable.
He's just a nice guy.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, I'd drink with him. I'd capture a mummy with him. He'd capture money with me. I'd get money with him. Hey, count my money.
Capture a mummy for the money with him. There you go.
There we go.
All right. Yeah. And last bit of movie news. Baby Driver trailer. It's like the third international one or something like that. It doesn't matter.
Got nowhere to run to, baby.
Oh, no. The tequila.
Tequila. Oh, yeah. Da, 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 da. Tequila.
Yeah.
That was good.
What did you guys think about this last trailer? I think it's the last trailer.
Yeah. It comes out like in 2 weeks.
The only, Mm-hmm. There's something I don't like about the trailer.
Which is?
It's, I haven't seen it yet.
Okay.
I haven't seen the movie yet. Oh. That's the only thing I don't like about it.
Right.
And people have seen it, and I'm obsessing over it. I cannot wait for this film. If I could only see one movie this summer, it would be that. It looks incredible.
No doubt. You know, Edgar Wright is, one of my favorite directors. And, you know, it seems like he's like, I don't know, like, you kind of wondered where he was going to go after Three Cornetos trilogy. And this is like, if he's going to do movies like these, it's like, oh, I want to see, needs to be more Edgar Wright movies because it just looks phenomenal. It looks like something
out, like a seven. We're not getting, we never got Ant-Man from him. I'm like, okay, I'm going to go do Baby Driver. And
don't bring that up.
Oh, I'm sorry.
His Ant-Man would have been awesome. How it came out was, you know, it was good, but
I liked Ant-Man, but Baby Driver looks incredible.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I like Ansel Elgort a lot. I loved Fault in Our Stars. I'm a big romantic comedy guy. Sorry for making you guys cry thinking about
Stars. You know what? The Fault in Our Stars surprised me. I was like, ugh, teen YA, whatever. And then I watched it and I was like, hey, this is like a real movie.
It's a really, really good movie.
Yes. And Ansel Elgort, that kid is really good. I would have been okay if he got cast as Han Solo, because I think he was in the running for a while too.
Yeah,
he was. And he was also in the running for Peter Parker for a little bit.
Actually.
But yeah, this looks good, and I think we're getting an action star in him.
Oh yeah, definitely.
It's gonna be good.
It's a great trailer.
Yes, it is.
All right, let's move on to the real topics of the show. May movie roundup. So May is over, gone. The first month of the summer movie season. What were your guys' favorite movies of May?
After
Eugene.
Oh, okay. I think Guardians and probably Alien Covenant. I really enjoyed.
Pick one and then give a quick review of it.
Okay. I think Alien Covenant I'm going to go with because I finally saw it. It finally explained everything it claimed it was going to explain, unlike Prometheus. I'm just going to go full on spoilers, and it was really cool to see the origin of the xenomorph, or, you know, the modern xenomorph. And, you know, all the David stuff was just so fucking interesting that, it had some faults, but it just made me, like, you know, still thinking about it probably like days after seeing it. So it left a pretty good impression.
Oh. Well.
Because you didn't like it, so.
No, I hated it. I did not like Alien Covenant.
We're going to end this call right now.
Okay. Well, this has been a good episode of The Wolf of Brisbane.
Thanks for stopping by, Brandon. Bye. No.
Okay.
Maybe we'll have a movie fight about Alien Covenant one day.
Okay.
About my, I am going to go with Guardians 2. That's my favorite movie of May. I loved it just as much as the first one. I thought it felt more Star Trek-y to me than Star Wars, and I liked that aspect of it. It brought something new to the table. I thought Kurt Russell was great. I cried numerous times, and a lot of people are saying, like, yeah, it's a little less eventful than the last one. I'm like, yeah, I kind of like that. It's more of a character study and getting to know these characters before Infinity War. And, Rocket was great. Baby Groot's adorable. And, yeah, it's my favorite movie of May. It's a good May I? bad pun.
I only saw three movies in May. And the third one comes out in June, so I'm just gonna pick Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 as well.
Yeah,
it kind of feels like. Well, I also love Alien Covenant, though. I don't want to disregard that. But
we're not twins.
Okay. No.
I loved Volume 2 a whole lot, and as it was over, I turned to Gene, and just immediately said, "I think this is my new favorite Marvel movie." And multiple viewings later, I think it is my new favorite Marvel movie. No, I know it is my new favorite Marvel movie.
Wow.
Before Age of Ultron.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's your favorite?
I have a whole thing about that. I don't want to get into it.
No, I like it. Yeah, I like it. I'm not going to. Yeah. Nothing. It's just not my favorite.
I will go scorched earth on this motherfucker. No.
Okay. Oh, no,
but,
shit.
But Volume 2, it really was just entirely driven by character and their emotions, you know? Basically, the point of the movie is a bunch of assholes learn to cry together, you know? Yeah. And it's not an overly complicated movie. There's a story there, but it's all driven by character. And I think that turned a lot of people off when they say, like, it's kind of messy or, like it doesn't feel as structured. Like it is structured. It's structured differently.
Structured.
Yeah, it's structured just totally different from how the superhero genre has kind of fallen into. You know, it gets a lot of criticism for having like Act 1, 2, and 3, and like there's a big action finale, and it's all here in Guardians 2 as well. But it's not plot based. It's just like, hey, these guys are upset. They're a bunch of assholes in space.
Mm-hmm.
They became a family. Now, do they actually want to be a family together? What does that mean to be part of a family?
Mm-hmm. Preach!
I loved it.
Preach!
I loved it so much.
Yes! Yes! Yes!
I'm glad we agree.
I know. I agree. Go away.
Oh, my God. That I had... tears, man. I was choking up. I was crying.
I cried numerous times.
Yeah.
The Mary Poppins, yo!
Oh, man. Yeah. That is... The more I think about it, the more it might be my favorite movie of the year. I don't know if it's, like, the best, but it's the one I keep, like, thinking about the most. Like, I just feel happy thinking about it, you know? Like, I think about Alien Covenant, but that was, like, a cosmic horror movie. Here, I think about Guardians, too, when I want to be, like, happy or want to dance to Mr. Blue Sky. And yeah, what a great fucking movie. So you know what? I'm going to do something over the course of time as we go into the next episode. I want to see how many people prefer Guardians 2 over Alien Covenant. So I'm just going to make like a week-long poll and see how people go about that. So yeah, for anybody listening after this, when this episode goes up, I'm going to make the poll. So
awesome.
Monday morning, check it.
Okay.
All right. And all of you who click Guardians, you are right, and Alien, you are wrong.
Yes. We'll see.
We will see.
I'd be actually very interested to see, it turns out, because they're both kind of divisive movies, actually, surprisingly, I thought.
Yeah, it's very divisive, and that's good. It gets people talking about movies and talking about their opinions. And
Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, that's what this whole, like, film discussion stuff is about, you know, the discussion, not, like, who's right and who's wrong. Like, it's kind of fun to joke about that, like, oh, wow, that's a bad opinion, but, you know, just don't be an asshole and treat others with respect.
Exactly.
You're all good.
Yeah, I mean, and this would be a pretty boring show if you were like, oh, I love it. I love it, too. Well, that was a good episode. Bye.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
We should all be entitled to our opinions.
And... Yeah, exactly. You should have heard me and Gene go off at each other over Kong versus Godzilla.
Yeah.
Oh, I did take a look at
that. Oh, thank you. Yeah, that was
like 30,
that was a good show.
30 minutes.
Thank you very much. Like,
yeah. A good discussion, but yeah.
All right. Speaking of discussions, let's move on to my favorite part of the show.
Ooh.
Pitch a movie. Brandon.
No.
Yeah, you remember this?
Yes, I did. This was fun.
All right. Yeah.
Can't wait for Paul Blart 5.
Oh, yeah. No, this time, you know, the studio system this summer, they're calling in low numbers for their blockbusters.
Oh, yes.
Audiences just aren't flocking to the summer movies this year. No one really knows why. Maybe critically, might be commercially.
Yeah.
Whatever.
It might be Netflix. It might be Amazon. We don't know.
People might just be recovering from Iron Fist still. No one knows. But it's your job to save it now. You have to pitch the perfect generic production blockbuster. You need
so much pressure.
You need to hit all quadrants. You need to get a romance in there between a man and a woman.
All right.
You need to get, because obviously, you know, producers don't understand that there are more than one type of romance. So you gotta
can it be? Doesn't have to be a man and a woman. Can it be a woman and a woman, or a man and a man?
Sure.
See, ideally, I want, like, in my perfect world, I'd want that, but I feel like I want you to pitch the most grindingly generic version.
You're right. This is Trump Nation. I should be very
exactly
homophobic. Yep, this is a man and a woman.
Like you can't even like let them have romantic tension. Like they look at each other one scene, then the next scene they're like married or some shit. You know, like just wow, the worst.
All right, we'll do. All right. Is that all? All right. Can you guys give me some elements so I can put on this pitch?
Oh, I'll just toss out one more. Awesome. You have to have a big explosive third act CGI fight.
Oh, I can't wait.
Oh, okay. Make it an aerial battle.
Oh, aerial with a laser shooting into space.
Aerial as in Little Mermaid or aerial?
Oh, you know, like all the Marvel Phase 2 movies had like all the aerial battles.
The big beam in the sky.
Yeah.
The big giant. I hate that shit. Okay. Big beam in, all right, cool. Big beam in the sky. Awesome.
Yeah. Oh, okay, I have one more note for you.
Yes, please.
It has to have the most blandest, boringest blockbuster star, which is who's the dude from Avatar? The
oh my god.
Jake Sully? Stan Worthington.
Yeah. It has to have Jake Sully. I forgot the actor's name. It's like
I was gonna say Jai Courtney.
Worthington? Was it?
It's Sam Worthington. But Jai Courtney is also acceptable.
Oh, okay.
He's also an Aussie with a chin. They kind of blend together.
Right.
Yeah. What is it with Australian actors that just like try to
become the next big thing?
It's so weird.
I have no idea.
Well, I think it's the Hugh Jackman effect. Ever since Hugh Jackman, the greatest Aussie. Thank you. Ever since he became a big star with Wolverine, then people were like, okay, who's the next big Aussie? We're all obsessed with Australia. Let's bring a new guy in. That might be it. I don't know.
Maybe. I can see that.
I'm just making it up. I don't know.
All right.
Cool. Anything else? Any other elements?
No. I think I'm good.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, no. Good on this end. We're going to take a quick break. We have a highlight, a quick interview from Star Wars Rebels press conference from Star Wars Celebration.
Tia, can you talk about what was going on when Dave announced the end of, that it was ended at season 4?
Could you tell that I was a little emotional? I knew it was coming. Well, we've known for a little while, if I can say that, and we weren't sure when you guys would find out, and so recently we saw each other, and I asked Dave, and he said, we're going to tell them in person and at Celebration. And I thought, oh, you cruel, cruel man, you're going to like break their hearts like in real life, just right there. And then I thought about it later and I thought, what a nice way to get to share that news with you in person rather than like putting out a press release and having people find out online and in this impersonal way. I thought we all get to be there to tell you together. And of course, I feel like heartbroken that it's ending, but also, you know, Dave told us something similar to what he told you guys, which is that we've told the story we wanted to tell, and we've gotten to end it on our own terms in a way that, you know, we all feel really good about. And so I was just feeling a lot of feelings, and I was happy to get to be there when we told everybody.
Dave is so mysterious, we're never sure if what he tells us is true.
That's true.
And we're back with the Waffle Press Movie Podcast. Hello again. How was your guys' break?
Oh, it was good.
It was wonderful. It was good. Soothing.
You know what else is soothing and wonderful to me?
What?
Action movies. Specifically, action blockbusters. They're my favorite thing. Or at least among my favorite things, because I like watching people hurt themselves for my entertainment. So,
enjoy other people's misery.
Exactly. In recent years, I think there's a good argument to be had about whether or not there are up-to-par blockbusters. And then I remember Mad Max Fury Road, and I'm like, oh, okay, no, good things still happen to good people. Like, obviously, you know, not everything's going to knock everything out of the park, but, you know, c'est la vie. What are some of your guys' favorite action sequences, like, stuff that really blew you away in recent blockbusters? And then we can talk about, like, the grander blockbuster stuff.
Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah, like recent, like how recent?
Like let's say like 5 years.
Sure. You know, the first thing that comes to my head is probably the
Inception set with was it Joseph Gordon-Levitt, and it's like moving. It's due.
That was like 7 years ago, but I'll let it slide.
Okay. Well, yeah. Okay. The hallway as it's like turning. There's like that whole fight that really, I really dug that. Because they use the same method that they did with 2001. They move their sets through space, and you know, they made it an action sequence. So you know, that was cool. That's the first thing that comes to mind. Probably some others. Diego, do you have any?
This is an easy pick, but I mean, Mad Max Fury Road, man.
Oh yeah.
I mean, that whole movie is an action set piece, but like, it's beautiful, and it's all, again, another blockbuster driven by character. Mm-hmm. But my favorite has to be the driven. My favorite has to be the end when they're racing back to the Citadel, and just watching how far Max and Furiosa have come to like just. They're so like in tandem with one another. They don't even have to say anything to each other during the fight, but they understand where they're going, what they're gonna do, and so they're like just giving each other a hand. Max gets flung to like another truck, and it's great. That is fantastic filmmaking.
Yes, it is. That's a good one.
How about you, Brandon?
I'm gonna go with John Wick.
Yes,
the first one where he's going, where the great Keanu Reeves is John Wick. Is pissed that they killed his puppy, and he is going in the club, and he is slicing and shooting guys one by one. It's almost one continuing shot, but the camera it doesn't. There's no quick cuts. There's no shaky cam. It's so beautifully done, and the choreography is terrific, and it's a beautiful film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love both John Wicks so much. I think the club scene in the first one might be the best action set piece though in the series.
Yeah, I think so.
I also like there's a moment in the scene. He kills a bunch of people in the bathhouse, then you know, races upstairs after Theon Greyjoy. Mm-hmm. And as he's making his way through the club, he just lightly brushes someone aside and then goes back to shooting people in the head.
it's so funny.
Yeah. And it's not even like a big thing. It's just like a nice casual cool Keanu Reeves walk. Excuse me, sir. Bam, 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 bam.
It's great. So yeah. And I've heard from the directors that in an interview with Screen Junkies that a bunch of the people that he was shooting, it's the same guy.
I fully believe that.
As the camera's going, a guy has a wig on and a beard, and then he would as he gets shot and he falls down, the camera pans away, then he runs behind the filmmakers and it shaves and then goes back in and gets killed again.
Oh, I love it.
That's awesome.
Because you can only hire like so many people with like that capability of stuntman, so yeah. That makes total sense. And you can't tell, so.
No, because it's done that well.
Yeah. Speaking long-term blockbusters, what do you think are some of the best action sequences like ever committed to an action movie?
Okay. I'll say one just to appease you, Diego, but I think the train sequence in Spider-Man 2.
Fuck yeah.
And Tobey Maguire's facial expression as he's holding his webs together, he's looks like he's taking a big poop. I love that.
Yeah, you know, like everyone like kind of makes memes out of it now, but it's like, yo, that dude is holding back a train. Like,
come on, man. I like to see you hold back a train with the like face like that.
Yeah, he's holding back a train, you know, and he just fought like an octopus man with robot tentacles. Like, chill. Right. The guys had a rough day.
Yeah. The crazy 88 fight also comes to mind from Kill Bill.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
That was a good one.
It goes from like black and white. Yeah, it's crazy.
I'll go with another Marvel movie, the Civil War fight, the airport scene. I mean, come on, man.
Just color grade that scene and it'd be perfect.
I think it's a beautiful, beautiful scene.
It was a joke for Marvel's color correction.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
I know.
I will also go on record as saying, because I had that complaint before. Guardians of the Galaxy 2 proves that they they can do it. So as long as they just keep committing to that, their movies look great.
Thor Ragnarok looks great. I think they're using cameras for that too. So should
be good. You know, I'll just keep in the superhero wheelhouse. The bridge sequence in The Winter Soldier.
I think it's
really, really exciting stuff.
Yes. The elevator scene in that film is amazing too.
Oh yeah, I was gonna say like that's another one, but the bridge one is what really gets me because it ends with a big reveal too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
Bucky. Who the hell is Bucky?
Yeah. And to change it up, I don't know if it fully counts as a blockbuster, but the shootout in Heat, it's like a 6-minute shootout in downtown LA.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, that's awesome.
It's just gunshots ricocheting and people falling to the ground and glass shattering. Mm-hmm. That is enticing stuff, you know, like that fully grabs you, forces you to watch it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Man. Yeah, the Russo brothers are amazing with action.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. Even going back to their Community, the paintball episode.
You know? Yeah, they direct the shit out of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They always
rumor has it that if you can direct comedy well, you can direct action well too.
Oh, okay. Because
all the timing is almost the same. Comedy's in threes and action's in threes. So expect something from director Dennis Dugan, the director of Adam Sandler films, very soon.
That's it.
That'd
be fun. Any other big action scenes? Because my mind immediately went to the truck chase in Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Oh, God.
Yes. Yes, that's classic.
That's great.
And all the action in Raiders of the Lost Ark is great. Yeah. All the action in Indiana Jones films is good. Except for Kingdom of Crystal Skull.
You know, I'll even go to bat for Crystal Skull as having some pretty good action sequences. Nothing on par with the original trilogy.
That swing in with the monkeys, man. Yeah.
Okay. There are low points.
Yeah.
But sure. The university chase in Crystal Skull. I think that's good, really good.
Oh yeah, that's good.
Yeah. Yeah, if I remembered it.
I think even like in the opening prologue, everything right before they nuke the fridge is really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
That's true. The thing in the warehouse with the boxes is okay.
Yeah, that was cool. And he you know, he falls and he's like, oh, not as spry as I used to be. You know, classic Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
There you go. There's a few others I could think of. The Matrix hallway. The lobby fight is really good.
Even the scene in Matrix Revolution. It's not a good movie, but the traffic scenes.
Cool.
Yeah,
that's great.
No, I'll go to bat. Yeah, the Matrix trilogy as a whole, like, say what you will about the sequels, the action's still there. It's still
really impressive. Of course. That's the only reason to watch them is the action. It's to watch the trilogy all the way through. Mm-hmm. Is all the action set pieces are really well done and cool looking.
I was holding this one off for the end, but I'll just say it now. Bad Boys 2. Is fucking
you insane. And Bad Boys 2.
You know what? That's the Citizen Kane of movies, Brandon.
Is this where they're going? Is this the Cuba scene I'm thinking of?
You know what? The Cuba scene is like legitimately like good. I think that's like one of the best Michael Bay sequences that he's
when he's ever. Like driving through all the houses and it's like they just happen to be abandoned.
Yeah, and they're like clearly not. Like they just clearly murdered dozens of people, if not hundreds. Like it's hilarious.
Yeah,
it's like Michael Bay has no contempt for humanity.
No,
he hates everyone, and
he hates everyone who watches his movies.
Fuck yeah, I love him.
Yeah,
I love him.
No, he likes his audience. I think he likes his audience.
No, like, I think he does too. It just
he likes Diego because he likes Bad Boys 2 that much.
Fuck yeah.
This audience of just like 13-year-old or teenage boys.
Have you seen that Ben Affleck commentary about Armageddon?
Oh yeah, that's the best.
Brilliant. It's brilliant. He's
just shut up. Just shut up, Ben.
He says something among the words about like, Oh,
why can't you just train miners to be at, or no, why can't you just train astronauts to be miners instead of training
miners? Like, and he told me to shut the fuck up. And that was the end of that conversation.
Best.
Oh, okay. Oh my God. I have another one. The original Pirates of the Caribbean trilogy, the ones directed by Gore Verbinski. Mm-hmm. Again, say what you will about the 2 and 3. The action in those
movies. No, I like 2.
I like 2 and 3.
Yeah.
I'm halfway there.
Very well shot.
Yeah.
I like 2. It's got some great action in it. And the barrel, not the barrel, the wheel in the second one is where they're having that three-way sword fight on the – that's a great set piece.
Mm-hmm. You know, no one makes movies like Gore Verbinski. That guy directs the shit out of anything. His movies might not always work entirely, but damn, that guy can make a production work.
Mm-hmm. That guy can make a movie.
Fuck yeah.
And he has. He's made movies.
He has made multiple movies. A couple of them are pretty dang good.
Yeah, a couple.
Yeah.
I like that.
Anyways.
Ranger. Cure for Wellness.
Yeah, like the 2/3 of A Cure for Wellness that were like the main movie he was making before he like jammed another movie in there was good. You know?
Oh, they didn't like the ending?
It's okay, it's fine. He just like jams like 2 movies in there, I felt like.
I don't feel
well, he always does that. He likes to pack a bunch of movies in one.
Yeah.
You know what? I like his ambition. You know, he never is lazy. You can never criticize Gore Verbinski for being like lazy. He's always really ambitious with his productions and his movies. So,
mm-hmm. Of course,
He always goes all out.
Always goes all out. Mm-hmm. And on that note, do you guys want to mention any other big action set pieces before we move on to the final part of the show?
I think I'm okay. I think I'm ready to pitch, or unless you got one more action sequence to talk about.
No, I'm good. Gene, you good?
Yeah, I'm good.
Yeah. Okay. I've got the clock ready. Okay. Brandon.
We're going to tell you.
You have 3
minutes. How many minutes? 3 minutes to pitch?
Yeah.
Okay.
Ready?
Cool.
3.
I'm ready.
2, 1, go. All
right. Guys, America sucks right now. It's horrible. Yeah. The president is dumb. Everything is bad. So we need a fun. Remember Independence Day? That was a fun movie. Not Resurgence. We need a movie to celebrate our patriotism and celebrate our freedom in the funnest, dumbest way possible. All right, so Sam Worthington in the beginning, he plays the president of the U.S. Don't ask me why. I know he's Australian. He can pull off an American accent. I believe in him. And there is this big – of course, there's this upbringing of elephants. But like big evil elephants, like from ones from Lord of the Rings or King Arthur for some reason, big elephants were in there. And there's this leader of the evil elephants is this big orange asshole named Donald Trunk, this big elephant that yells mean things. And then he kills the president, Sam Worthington. But of course his VP always has his back. And who plays his VP? Dwayne Johnson as himself. Dwayne Johnson said he would run for president, but now he has become the president because the president has died and has VP. He must take that ring and form. And just like we're getting Rampage with him fighting monsters, kaiju, no, we don't need that. We want him fighting these big elephants and taking them down and, of course, killing the evil Donald Trunk. And you got to know, when he kills all the elephants, all the other elephants from space are mean. That they have awakened. And a big beam up in the sky, just like you've seen in the Avengers, but this one's bigger and better, and it shoots up in the sky, and all the elephants from space have awakened, and they're going to take the planet down. But the president Rock says, you don't fuck with U.S. Get it? You don't fuck with us. Mm-hmm. Us, US. All right. And of course, we got The Rock's got a first lady, the great Rosario Dawson, because she makes every movie better. And they have a lovely romantic scene before this all happens, so he can get his energy up. And The Rock gets bigger from going into he's also the Wolfman because he's made a deal with Universal. So he can grow very big and defeat all these elephants and kill them all and spit. And this movie fights for our freedom. This movie's about America. And I know what you're thinking, audience. This is a clusterfuck. And that's the point. That's what we love. That's why we love this summer. It's just a big mess of action and The Rock punching things and fighting for our freedom. This movie is called Born.
Time.
As in Born. Oh, okay, I was going to say Born on the 4th of July, but that's already a movie.
Gene, what do you think?
I really dig it. Any movie that gets rid of a Donald Trump parody, I'm fully on board with. So yeah, I don't know, I'll buy it, whatever these kids are watching nowadays.
You know, Donald Trump immediately won me over, and then you cast Rosario Dawson as the first lady. Yeah, I'm giving this movie all my money.
You can't go wrong with that. Yeah. You can't go wrong with that. Thank you. Thank you.
We'll call it Project how do you pronounce it? Confafi?
Oh, Confifi?
Pardon?
Confifi.
Confifi?
Confifi, yeah.
God damn it.
Oh, and that's the elephant's alien language, Confifi.
Confifi.
Yeah. Kids don't want Transformers. They want elephants, right?
Hell yeah. Oh, my God. I want a poster of this somewhere so badly.
Yeah. For those who are listening, make a poster. I want to see some nice Photoshops. I want to see some cool-looking Photoshops. It's called Born on the 4th of July, as in Jason Bourne, spelled like that. Bourne on the 4th of July. Let's make this happen.
And then it's crossover with the Bourne franchise as well, obviously.
Oh, yeah. And, Matt Damon can be the secretary, so we'll get that going.
All right, so yeah, I've totally watched Born on the 4th of July.
Awesome.
As we wrap up the show, what are some quick little movie reviews you guys want to give? Anything you've seen in the theaters, smaller movies you want to highlight, or any TV shows you want to highlight?
I want to do one like just right off the bat, because I feel like no one was really, well, I mean, some people are watching it, but like it didn't get the audience that should have. The Samurai Jack revival, just really, I really fucking dug so fucking much. It came out on Adult Swim back in March, and it's lasted till like, it ended like 2 weeks ago, and just like, oh my God, because, you know, Gendy, it was like Brendan Hodgkin. Yeah, he's such like a good like action. He does such good action sequences, and his pacing is so awesome. But this was like, you know, his like finest of all his work, like better than Clone Wars, better than like.
Really?
Yeah, it was like his magnum opus. It was just so fucking good. And like, you know, the opening scene, I don't know if I was just like going through a lot, but it was, you know, the opening scene just kind of makes you tear up a little bit, because it's all silent, like the first 4 minutes of the first episode are silent, and it's like it was just all through like pacing and like, you know, he you know how he reveals Jack, and like the ending is really good. It's just a little spoilers, it's very bittersweet, but like, you know, it's such a good ending to the show that like, you know, 15 years ago it started and then it got canceled, and then 10 years of people have been waiting for an ending. You know, it's so fucking good. I think I put the last frame of it on my Instagram, because I love the last shot, and I think everyone really needs to check it out. Yeah, all I cannot state how much I love that revival.
Wow.
You know, I think it really improved my storytelling abilities, to be honest. Yeah,
I have not seen it yet. Yeah, I watched a couple episodes in preparation for the revival, and then I held off because I wanted to sit through it all in like one sitting.
Yeah, it's only like 4 hours.
Yeah, so I watched like one little movie, I guess a long movie, but I'm really looking forward to that. Samurai Jack has always been one of my favorite shows. Three Blind Archers was my favorite episode from the original run. So I'm really looking forward to seeing if there's anything that can like give me that same rush when I first saw that episode. Well,
those archers are back.
Oh, why would you say that? That's a cool surprise.
Well, I don't know. I'm sorry, but
it's all right. It's all right. Brandon, anything you've seen recently you want to highlight?
Captain Underpants is fun.
Hell yeah.
I could have seen Wonder Woman last night, but I was being a kid and I saw Captain Underpants instead. It's a lot of a fun movie. I'm a big fan of the books. I grew up with them. I read them a lot as a kid. I still read a new one when it comes out. Don't judge me. And it's a lot of fun. The actors do a great job. I like that they cast adults, Kevin Hart and Thomas Middleditch as the kids, George and Harold.
Does that work?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I didn't think it would work, but it totally works. I totally bought it. I never questioned it.
Okay. I'll give it a chance.
Yeah, Ed Helms is great as Captain Underpants, and it's a lot of fun, and I was never bored. There was not a moment where I was not enjoying the film. Oh.
Does it have Flip-O-Rama?
Yes.
Oh, it does.
It's great.
I never thought they would be able to do it, but they did it, and
that's awesome.
Fantastic.
It is. Yeah. Just to bounce off you, Brandon. It is. It's. You know, it might even be a great movie. It's a very good one at the very least. It's a.
It is.
It is just as heartfelt as it is clever and witty, and it doesn't shy away from its feelings on the American education system. Which I also greatly appreciate, because it's kind of bullshit.
For
yes, it is.
Yeah,
yes, it is.
But no, it was a huge surprise to me. I was like, I hope it's like watchable. You know, like I want to make memes out of it at the very least, like the Boss Baby. But no, this yeah, is
you love them Boss Baby memes.
Oh, the Boss Baby memes are the best. But no, this is like a way better movie. It's a real movie.
Well-crafted movie, and. I was as a fan of the show, of the books, I'm really happy. I'm very
happy. Yeah, there was something. I watched it for SoCal Thrills with my buddy Patrick from Real Film Chatter, and there was something I mentioned from the books that I always liked a lot, and I was like, I hope I see that in the movie. And I won't spoil what it is, but Brandon, at the end of the movie, they do that, and I was just
giddy. Yes, they do.
I was very giddy.
Me too. Yeah, there's so many fan references for you, but nothing too, like, in your face. It was all...
Okay.
It's all there. It's like, yeah, it's very well done.
Yeah. Good job, Captain Underpants.
Good job, DreamWorks. And I hope... And this is called Captain Underpants, the first epic movie. I hope it's not the first and last epic movie.
Yeah, because I feel like Wonder Woman's going to get all the... Deservedly so, if apparently Wonder Woman is apparently very, very good.
Yeah, it's getting a lot of good... I'm excited to see it, but people should go check out Captain Underpants. It deserves all your support.
Yeah, I hope both these movies make money.
Me too.
For the right reasons. It's
a solid weekend of superhero movies.
Yeah, it really is, and I didn't expect that. And I'm happy that seems to be the case.
Yeah.
And let's see, what else have I seen? That's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. That was it.
Oh.
I mean, Alien Covenant, but yeah, we already talked about that. Oh, there you go. Plugs. My Alien retrospective series that took place over the course of an entire year with Matt Garingo is finished. We recorded an Alien Covenant episode, and that'll be going up the same week as this episode. So stay tuned for that.
Ooh. Cool.
We have thoughts on Alien Covenant. You guys already know I like it. But
did he like it?
That's his question. You have to listen to find out.
Oh, you're making me. Ooh, you're getting me excited.
You will find out within the first second of the episode.
All right. So if he likes it, I will tune out. I'm kidding. I'll give it a listen. I always enjoy listening to your guys' stuff. You guys, it's a lot of fun.
Oh, thanks, man.
This is a great show. And I'm happy to be a guest sometimes. Everyone's up.
Yeah, we're always happy to have you, man. Thanks for doing this again.
Yeah, my pleasure. It's a lot of fun. Thank you guys for having me, as always.
Yeah. All right, plugs. What do you got, Brandon?
You can go subscribe to Bmoneyrulz. That's B and the word money and R-U-L-Z, where I do trailer mashups, movie reviews. You can catch my review of Captain Underpants and Wonder Woman as soon as I see it. I'm doing something with Baby Driver that I think people are going to really dig. Yeah, and also follow me on Twitter and Instagram at bswafs, and continue watching the Waffle Press because these guys do great stuff.
Thank you so much for that.
Yeah, thank you, man.
Yes, definitely check out Brandon's stuff. Gene, what do you got?
You could find me on Twitter, Instagram, Gene9892, all around. On Facebook, look up We Own Nothing Films. And check out Alien Convergence on VOD or DVD.
Yes, you know, no relation to Alien Covenant, of course.
Yeah, except the font.
Oh, thank God. So now I'm even more intrigued.
Yeah,
there you go.
Somebody brought that around.
They just have similar titles.
Okay.
I'm looking forward to it. I thought the poster actually looks pretty cool. So
I liked
it. Yeah, that was cool. Better than most of the posters released today.
Right.
Spider-Man Homecoming.
Better than that Homecoming poster.
Yeah, what is that, man? I'm trying to get all excited for another Spider-Man movie and they just keep tossing this shit in their face.
Yeah, and most Marvel. Sorry, I'm going off a tangent here.
No.
Most Marvel.
Yeah, dude, fuck it. It's the end of the show. Marvel. The wild.
Yeah, most Marvel posters kind of suck. But this one's just clustered. And it's got two Iron Mans and two Vultures, and Jon Favreau is on the poster because he's why kids will see the movie. Right.
Yeah. Happy Hogan.
It's really weird. It's weird. It's really weird.
And you know what sucks? The first Homecoming, the teaser poster, I actually really, really liked.
Yeah, the one where he's sitting down and the Avengers tower is in the back. Yeah. It's awesome.
Yeah, that's a good poster.
Photoshop ruined the game. Photoshop ruined everything.
Yeah. Well, you can also check out more Spider-Man ramblings on my Twitter account because I happen to like that character a little bit. D-E-double-G-O Waffles, that's Diego Waffles. President Diego is the Twitter handle. All of my links to everything I do over there, there's a lot. Audienceseverywhere.net. I have a full written review for Captain Underpants that just came out there. Some writings on Alien Covenant. Some of the overarching themes it reveals about the series that I really, really like. Also, I basically just put heart eye emojis next to David's name a dozen times. So, yeah, right. Check out that stuff. I like that villain a lot. I like talking about movies, and I like hearing feedback. So, like, subscribe if you like this video. If you didn't like and subscribe anyways, because you might find something you do like. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, subscribe anyway. It's free. Who cares?
Yeah.
You might find something that you like later. Subscribe. What you doing?
Yeah. You know what? Yeah. Do that. Yeah. All right. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. We have been professionally unprofessional.
Very professional.